Now it's time for Lefties Losing It. We'll be looking at the mass media meltdown on MSNBC, CNN and other networks following the great vice presidential debate. But first, let's hear from the main white dude for Kamala, her husband, Doug Emhoff, who stands accused of forcefully slapping a former girlfriend. And we know he cheated on his first wife with the nanny, even got the nanny pregnant. But please, Doug, lecture us about toxic masculinity.
There's too much of toxicity. It's masculine toxicity out there. And we've kind of confused what it means to be a man, what it means to be masculine, where you've got this trope out there that you've got to be tough and, you know, angry and lash out to be strong.
You don't say, Doug. Thank God no one would claim that you are reshaping the concept of masculinity.
How your role has reshaped the perception of masculinity, and I'm not sure you planned on that, but you are an incredibly supportive spouse. Has that been an evolution for you, and do you think that's part of the role you might play as first gentleman?
It's funny, I've started to think a lot about this. I've always been like this. My dad was like this.
Always been like this. Yikes. The next Lefty Losing It is a regular on this segment. We've become accustomed to the unhinged musings of Joy-Ann Reid, and here's yet another example.
And so I think that the people who want the fistfight are the base of the Democratic Party. Mm. Democrats want to see someone get up there and give a knuckle sandwich to Donald Trump. That's what they want.
But when it comes to MSNBC, you know, there is great competition among the divorce from reality left. They all want to be the most radical, the most crazy. And Nicole Wallace came in with this effort after J.D. Vance's dominant performance in the vice presidential debate. Even the New York Times called it dominant. But according to Wallace, J.D. Vance fact-checking the biased moderators who happened to be female amounted to mansplaining, and that would repel female voters.
Yeah. And I actually think if you're a woman, that might be the worst moment J.D. Vance had, because he was going to mansplain right over that mute button. And again, I don't pretend to know how everyone will react to this. I think that a lot of women in positions of authority that should command respect just by virtue of that dynamic will see themselves and some dude that disrespected them and talked over. I mean, there was a moment like that with then vice presidential in the Harris-Pence debate.
So women should be treated as equals unless they're leftist activists masquerading as impartial journalists or moderators. Then you should just let them lie without feedback. And here is Rachel Maddow claiming that J.D. Vance was just slick and Tim Walz was the clear winner.
That one of these candidates is much slicker than the other, is a much more practiced kind of professional debate style speaker, and the other candidate won. There was one bad moment for Tim Walz in this debate where he got mixed up and embarrassed in answering a question about exactly what month he had been in China in relation to the Tiananmen Square protest.
Yes, that awkward moment when he lied about lying and then lied some more.
Governor Walz, you said you were in Hong Kong during the deadly Tiananmen Square protest in the spring of 1989. But Minnesota Public Radio and other media outlets are reporting that you actually didn't travel to Asia until August of that year. Can you explain that discrepancy?
Yeah, well, and to the folks out there who didn't get at the top of this, look, I grew up in small rural Nebraska, a town of 400, town that you rode your bike with your buddies till the streetlights come on, and I'm proud of that service.
What now? You are proud of riding bikes with your buddies until the lights come on? What does that mean, and what has it got to do with lying about where you were during the Tiananmen Square massacre? Walz's answer was so bizarre that even the biased CBS moderator was compelled to ask a follow-up question after he waffled on like that for more than 2 minutes. Just nonsense about himself that had nothing to do with the question asked.
Governor, just to follow up on that, the question was, can you explain the discrepancy?
Just, all I said on this was, is I got there that summer and misspoke on this. So I will just, that's what I've said.
Tim Walz is so dopey that he makes Joe Biden look cognitively sharp. Joe has said some bizarre stuff over the years, but He's never claimed to be mates with school shooters.
Yeah, I sat in that office with those Sandy Hook parents. I've become friends with school shooters.
Yes, Tim Walz is a masterful communicator, isn't he, Jen?
We've talked about this a little bit when we were sitting over there waiting. I think Tim Walz is one of the best communicators out there in Democratic politics. And he propelled himself onto the ticket because he is such an effective, good communicator.
As we document MSNBC hosts losing it, we cannot overlook the thoroughly wacky Simone Sanders. Here she seems to be upset that Tim Walz was not feral enough. There was too much niceness.
There were so many niceties on that debate stage tonight. I am just kind of like, well, if you agree so much with J.D. Vance, why should they vote for you? I fully believe that Governor Walz went out there tonight and did what was practiced in debate prep, did what the strategy was that the team put together. That was not the Governor Walz that I had seen out on the campaign trail. That's not the Governor Walz that I had seen during the Veep stakes, right?
Of course, Wallace and Maddow are there on the panel nodding along. And Sanders wasn't done yet. She also thought the biased CBS moderators were not biased enough.
That's not the Margaret and Nora that I know. Margaret don't do that on Sunday morning. So I just think that I know that there's so many people out there that want normal. They want normalcy. They just want, you know, just be able to just disagree with someone. Oh, you said a lot of things I agree with. This is not a normal election. J.D. Vance is actually not Paul Ryan. And Donald Trump sure as heck is not Mitt Romney. Okay?
But just when you think Sanders might be the front runner for the most unhinged take of the night, we got this from MSNBC anchor Nicole Wallace.
It's the audacity. I agree with you that we're in year nine and no one knows how to cover the audacity. Mm-hmm. The audacity is it someone should have said, stop it, stop, stop. Are you effing kidding me? And they should have dropped that F-bomb, right? I mean, they should have just, this is a debate. This may be the only chance people have to see the difference.
Now, if you thought it's just unhinged women on MSNBC, then you're wrong. They have many, many equally unhinged men. We just heard Joy Reid talking about Trump being punched in the face. And here is MSNBC panelist Eddie Glaude saying the same thing along with a bunch of other wild, crazy crap. This is MSNBC, folks.
And this man is running around here busting his chops, scaring the hell out of communities. Right. And we're trying to figure out how to keep that middle, you know, locked in on her when she needs to bust him in his mouth. I'm saying it like that because he's dangerous. He's dangerous to particular people. And the history of the country is such that we can't play fast and loose with it. Fast and loose.
But isn't it incumbent on all of us to protect the people who are in danger by him?
But you never have. That's the rub. You never have.
Now, of course, Nicole Wallace didn't challenge any of that insane rhetoric, including the comment about busting Trump in the face and about his claims that Trump is a danger. No, she just agreed with him. All this after two assassination attempts in 2 months. And the mad rant went on further. Here is Eddie claiming Trump being elected again will leave children traumatized. Did I mention this hysteric is a professor?
Because we got to keep this troglodyte out of office. Because if he comes in, our babies are going to be in danger. Because remember, those young children are going to grow up with the memory of having to not go to school for the threat of bombs. And somebody told them that their moms and dads eat cats, if they eat cats and dogs. I'll get myself together, Claire.
Okay, take a minute. Deep breaths.
Yes, deep breaths. Maybe you should have got yourself together before you went on television and spewed a bunch of deliberate lies and hysteria. And the leftist media had a new word to describe J.D. Vance's dominant performance in the debate. It wasn't a word like dominant or informed, competent, confident. No, no, no. They had something better, a backhander. See if you can spot it in this compilation.
J.D. Vance was as slick as a Neo last night.
He was
too slick, maybe.
He's a little too slick for that.
Vance came off a bit slick tonight.
J.D. Vance was a very slick debater.
The slicker speaker.
I think he looked at shifty. He looked at slick.
Over and over, you heard lies and kind of slick answers from J.D. Vance.
J.D. Vance changes personalities like most people change suits. Slick, slick, slick.
When you look over at J.D. Vance, you see a slick guy.
We all know, having worked with Van Jones, how these Yale-educated lawyers very slick.
No matter how slick J.D. may have sounded today, there is nothing decent about him.
This man is standing here lying to the country, and that's where J.D. Vance was his slickest.
You know, J.D. Vance was very slick, but he was slick like a snake oil salesman. Oh.
J.D. Vance is slick and smooth, but he is still a bull artist.
And let's end Lefties Losing It with the epicenter of lefty lunacy. Yes, we're ending with the ladies of The View. Here is Whoopi Goldberg claiming that the far-left Hollywood echo chamber, well, it's actually right-wing. This is a response to actor Zachary Levi coming out as conservative, knowing full well that it's probably going to damage or even end his career.
Within my industry, as you can probably imagine, Hollywood is a very, very liberal town, and this very well could constitute career suicide.
So, okay. That's not necessarily true. From the beginning of Hollywood, there have been, it's always been a very right-leaning town. But yeah. I know you don't know much about the Hollywood history, so let me school you.
Oh, dear. Whoopi's going to be schooling us. This should be good. I bet she'll be able to name just dozens of prominent conservatives in the industry, famous actors we've all heard of. She could barely remember the term Republicans there. I bet she doesn't know too many.
But the truth of the matter is, very few people seem to bite it because they're Republican. John Voight, who is working.
Dennis Quaid.
Dennis Quaid, who is working. People who work, stop that. It's more BS.
Yeah.
And it's unnecessary.
Oh, dear. She managed to name two dudes. And those two dudes have had their careers impacted negatively because of their politics. Talk about proving Zachary Levi's point completely. Joining me now is Sky News contributor Kosha Gaida. Kosha, we've heard a lot about J.D. Vance mansplaining during that debate. Do you think Nicole Wallace has a point there? Will the female audience be repelled by that sort of behaviour from J.D. Vance? Or even if what he was saying was factual, is the fact that he was speaking over two female moderators a bad look?
No, I never understood the mansplaining concept. You explain and it doesn't matter what lady parts you have on the other side when you're on the receiving end of explanations. I think that was grasping for straws. What he did do, I think, was actually very masterful, where he did what all Trump supporters were frustrated that Trump didn't do in the first debate, where he fought back against the incorrect fact check. But he did it still in a nice way, a firm but nice way. Mm-hmm. And I think overall, what comes across from J.D. Vance and what people remember is he actually showed a different dimension of his personality, somebody who's a bit softer and charming, mm-hmm. even, as opposed to the combative J.D. Vance that we've seen, which also has its place.
Yeah.
And he kept everything in the realm of that. I don't think mansplaining is something that people are going to take away from it.
No, and I did see a very interesting bit of analysis that he had the lowest likability or approval rating of the four candidates, Trump, Harris, Walz, and they said that is an absolute condemnation of the media, because if you look at the individuals, he's by far, by any sort of objective measure, probably the most intelligent and likeable and normal and relatable, especially given his background. And yet he's been painted as this bogeyman by so many in the media. Now, the Biden-Harris administration's inadequate response to the victims of Hurricane Helene continues, with the vice president finally touching down in Georgia today. We're about a week after the damage was inflicted, and she had this to say.
And the federal relief and assistance that we have been providing has included FEMA providing $750 for folks who need immediate needs being met.
Kosha, there's been a lot of criticism about the measly sum offered there. Obviously, there'll also be some short-term accommodation for certain people, but you compare that to the largesse and the money spent in total on illegal immigrants, housing them long-term in hotels and elsewhere. Mm-hmm. And then you look at the people who've been left homeless with Hurricane Helene, and their citizens have contributed taxes, and they seem to be getting very little.
Yeah, that juxtaposition in a government gone wild, the bloat and spending to all sorts of foreign causes, as you mentioned, and then nothing for these victims, for sealing the border, for other natural disasters. Hawaii had these huge bushfires, wildfires a while back, and that was inadequate, the response. The train derailment and the chemical spill disaster in East Palestine, Ohio was another example where they just never went and didn't do much. In that case, a man-made disaster. It's not lost on people. And the other thing that it reminds me of is Hurricane Katrina in the Bush years. He was accused, Bush, of being too slow, and I think he was. The response from FEMA and all the things that he green-lighted took a little bit too long. And the media made a huge story out of that, and it really was a stain on his presidency that he never recovered from. So that juxtaposition is also really interesting, where it's just another media test, and you can see where they focus and where they give a free pass. And it's a shame, because they're real people who are really hurting and have died.
Absolutely, and some of them are people who can least afford something like this happening. They just don't have the means to recover quickly from such a disaster. Now, the Daily Mail is reporting that Kamala Harris's husband, Doug Emhoff, allegedly slapped his ex in the face so hard that she spun around while waiting in a valet line at the 2012 Cannes Film Festival. The Daily Mail reports further, one of the alleged victim's friends said that the woman called him immediately after this incident, sobbing in the cab and describing the alleged assault. Daily Mail is not naming the woman, who is a successful New York attorney. Kosha, this is an explosive story. It's interesting to see which media outlets are following this, which ones are just completely ignoring it. But it is certainly a story that the Daily Mail felt deserved to be published, and they do seem to have spoken to multiple people connected with this.
Yeah, so it's allegation. Not confirmed yet, but you're right, there's a lot of detail in it and a lot of corroborating witnesses or alleged corroborating witnesses. It is an explosive story. Now, it is important to note that Doug Emhoff is not on the ticket, so the scrutiny that he deserves is
but
less.
But he is being promoted.
Yes.
Only just, I think, a few days ago, Jen Psaki interviewed him and said he was a new, improved
version of paragon of masculinity. And that's the thing. He stepped in it. Like, had he kept
quiet.
And he's
spoken about it in the past.
Yes.
About how he wants to get rid of toxic masculinity and how important that is.
That's a thing. So otherwise you could sort of draw a line and say family members should be scrutinized, but not to the same level of heat as the candidates himself, except if you insert yourself into the limelight. And the whole thing with the nanny, allegedly, where he had an affair with his first wife, with the nanny, that's one thing, and then this thing. So when these people try to present themselves as our moral betters, and then these stories break, it is relevant, but I don't think people are going to dig into it, and you won't find this story in too many outlets.
And I can assure you, if it was the better half of a Republican candidate, one who was going to be vice president or president, even in this case, there would be far more scrutiny, and the media would be far more interested. Kosha Gaita, thank you so much for your time this evening.
Sure.